So I'm here with Chris Todd from Brighton Hove Friends of the Earth. We're going to be discussing the history of the South Downs, 10-year anniversary of the South Downs National Park. You were at the start. How did it all happen?
Well, actually, I wasn't. Because if you trace the actual big history of this, it started in the 1920s when you had the formation of the Society of Sussex Downsmen.
Yeah.
They were quite an establishment body now, but at the time were quite radical, going up and ripping up fences on the South Downs. And, you know, also Campaign for Protection of Rural England was established then. 1947, just after the Second World War, there was a recommendation that South Downs, along with 11 other landscapes, should be made national parks. And then, following on from that, was the legislation to enable that to happen. But it never quite happened in the South Downs. The land-owning interests saw to that in a way, and we ended up with a lesser designation in the 1960s. Two areas of outstanding natural beauty covered what is now covered by the South Downs National Park. So you had the Sussex Downs and the East Hampshire. That provided an element of protection, but not the same protection and holistic outlook that a National Park Authority can have.
Right. Is that anything to do with the Town and Country Planning Act then, about when the national parks were established, or was that a completely separate piece of legislation?
It was a separate piece of legislation, but obviously the two are linked because development in national parks is much constrained in comparison to elsewhere. Ordinary sort of housing, small-scale development in keeping with the surroundings is perfectly acceptable. But major development has to undergo quite a series of tests and challenges before it's even, you know, considered acceptable to build in a national park. And generally those tests aren't met. And so you don't see generally large-scale development happening in those areas.
You're going to talk about that. It was the 1990s, wasn't it, really, when it first came on back on the agenda again?
Yeah, it was the late 80s, 1990. The South Downs campaign was established. I wasn't involved with it at that point. Again, pushing for the national park, pushing for better protection for this area because it wasn't receiving it. And at the time, the Conservative government and the Countryside Commission, which was the government's advisory body on landscape, were dead against any new national parks. For the campaigners, the issue was the South Downs was one of the 12 original areas proposed to be a national park, and it was one of the few that wasn't still. So it was it and the New Forest weren't national parks. So there was a sort of sense of injustice and grievance that, you know, they hadn't been made that. From the 1990s, the Countryside Commission sort of drew the sting out of the campaign, if you like, by saying we'll set up a conservation board, which was a sort of a bit of a halfway house between what they had originally and a national park. But again, it had no powers over planning, and it didn't have secure long-term funding. And so it was always hamstrung and actually quite often danced to the tune of the local authorities, who quite often were the problem in the areas anyway, because they could be sort of judge and jury in terms of what they allowed. So they want something to happen, and they could allow it to go ahead because they were in charge of planning.
Were there any key bits which you look back on and think, oh, that should have been part of the national park, which was subsequently built on, for example?
Not really, to be honest. I mean, most of what we saw, actually, what we ended up with was bigger than what was designated in the 1960s as part of the area of outstanding natural beauty. There were a few exceptions around places like Brighton, for example, with the bypass being built. A few of the sort of bits of land that were south of the bypass were left out of the national park. But by and large, overall, there was a lot more. I mean, for me, my involvement started in 95, and I got phoned up by Adam Trimmingham from the Evening Argus at the time. And he asked me, what did I think about Brighton Council selling off the South Downs? And I'd not been that long involved with Friends of the Earth, and I didn't know much about, you know, the South Downs at that point. So I made up some sort of inane comment. People like John Carden, whose relative Herbert Carden, he's a sort of a relative of Sir Herbert Carden, who was Order Master of Brighton back in the sort of late 19th century, early 20th yeah. century.
Codnab.
Exactly.
Yeah.
He bought up a lot of the downland and then passed it over to the council at cost price to enable basically to protect the South Downs from development and to protect the town's water supply. So very far-sighted person. He had some rather wild ideas for central Brighton, but he was very good on, in terms of protecting the South Downs.
Yeah.
So we formed a group called Keep Our Downs Public, and we managed to stop the council selling off all the downs. People thought originally it was going to be sold to the National Trust because the council sold Devil's Dyke and Saddlescombe Farm to the National Trust and at the same time announced it also wanted to sell the rest of the downland. Everyone thought it was all going to the National Trust, so what was the problem? Once you give up ownership of something, you have very little control over it. And, you know, a landowner can do all sorts of things that, you know, it's very hard to have control over. So, for example, if you're a landholder, certainly a public landholder, and the public interest is concerned about biodiversity, and there is a lot of concern about that at the moment, about, you know, loss of species, insect decline, you can, you know, make provision to allow for more environmentally friendly farming that encourages wildlife to flourish. If you give it away or sell it off, then you've got no control what happens to that land at all.
Yeah.
It could turn into a shoot, intensive farming. It could be sort of incrementally nibbled away with bits and pieces of development. But basically out of it, and out after we gave the council a bloody nose, if you like, stopped them selling it off, they came round to the idea that actually a national park was a good way forward. And we convinced them, and to their credit, they backed the national park. And that, in a sense, is what helped push it to the national arena, because it was in 97 that Labour government, you know, or Labour, Tony Blair won, you know, after a long period of Conservative rule. But it wasn't just that. I mean, we had a couple of events that hit the national headlines just before the 97 general election. One was a farmer ploughing up chalk grassland over in Shoreham. And we'd had 5 years of public money spent on putting this land back to chalk grassland just for him to turn around in a break clause in his contract and rip it all up. So 5 years of funding completely and utterly wasted. So that hit the national headlines and got local interest. And then a week later, 3 weeks before the general election, we had a farmer harmer over at Oatham Down ploughing up a nationally important wildlife site. And that was when the whole thing went ballistic. We had Tony Blair answering a question about it when he came down to Sussex University. We had all sorts of prospective parliamentary candidates, including the future Environment Minister, Michael Meacher, visiting the site. And we had John Gummer, who was the Secretary of State for the Environment at the time, being forced to issue a stop notice to stop the farmer doing any more damage. Because of the furore that had been created.
John Gummer, former Environment Secretary under John Major.
Yes, so he was still the Environment Secretary while the election period was going on.
Yeah.
So he had to step in and intervene, and he'd only ever done that 4 times previously, and he'd been there a long time. So it was quite exceptional, but that's what pushed it into the national arena. That's what got it into the attention of the incoming Labour government. And that's ultimately why it was successful in becoming a national park later on, because it was then that the Labour announced in 99 with John Prescott that they wanted to see 2 new national parks in the South Downs and the New Forest. And from there, they also created a new landscape advisory body called the Countryside Agency.
Yeah.
And it was them that then recommended to government that they re-examine the case for the national park in the South Downs and the New Forest. From 99, we thought it was going to be a few years.
Yeah.
And I was employed from 2001. It wasn't until 2010 that the whole thing was sort of signed, sealed and delivered, if you like, because we got caught up in all sorts of arguments about whether you could have a national park with more than one characteristic. And this was linked to what had happened in the New Forest, where there'd been an argument that you could only have a national park, only had to have a core characteristic. Well, anyone who knows other national parks, particularly something like the Peak District, which has got lots of different characteristics, knows that historically that was complete nonsense. National parks have lots of different characteristics, both between them and within them. And so to argue, which was being argued and used against the South Downs, just to have a chalk hills only national park and not including parts of the Weald, was a complete nonsense. But it, legally, it tripped the whole process up, so it dragged it right out.
OK, we'll leave it there for now. Join us for the second half. We're going to be talking to Chris Todd a lot more about South Downs National Park and about that process for it becoming enacted in law. So join us for the second half shortly. So welcome back to the vote. I'm here with Chris Todd from Brighton Hove Friends of the Earth, talked about South Downs National Park. At the end of the first half, we were talking about that process of it becoming enacted in law. It's lucky we had it enacted in law, because I think a lot of the South Downs, or at least some of it, would have been built on by now, given the need for home building in the South East. Is that right? Is that accurate, do you think?
It's difficult to tell. I think more would have been developed than has been. An area of outstanding natural beauty does have, restrictions on what can be built, but I think it's generally seen as much weaker because there's no body in charge of planning, no single body for an area of outstanding natural beauty, and it's left with the local authorities. And the local authorities in the South Downs area were a complete mixed bag. There were some very good local authorities, and there were some appalling local authorities. And so there was no consistency, and there was real damage being done in some areas and not in others. And so what a national park has done has bring that sort of holistic oversight to planning. It's levelled it up, hopefully lifted it up, so you have a much more consistent and higher quality planning process across the whole length of the South Downs. Now, it doesn't please everyone because it still allows development, and I think you have to recognise that things still have to have the ability to change and evolve, but they're meant to change and evolve in a way that respects the landscape, which is the primary purpose of the National Park Authority, which is to conserve the landscape.
What kind of criteria do you need to satisfy?
Well, generally, if it's a minor application, then those will go through a bit like they will go through a local authority process, and by and large, a lot of the planning is delegated or devolved back to the local authorities. But the critical thing is that for anything that's contentious or a major development, the National Park Authority can call it in or will examine it itself. And the test has to be, it's got to be in the national interest, and there aren't other ways of actually providing for that development, either within or without of the national park.
There's not much of that left, is there?
In
the South Downs. Tell us about that as well.
Yeah. Last November was the 10th anniversary when Hilary Benn actually signed the orders, but they came into effect. They came into effect on the 31st of March. Yeah. So, we've had a plaque made, which the park's really kindly paid for, which is now in Ditchling on the wall of the Nutmeg Tree Cafe in Ditchling, commemorating that act. We've done our celebrations. The National Park Authority is now coming up to its celebrations, because it's marking the 31st of March as the sort of key date, and I think it's got a year of celebrations of its 10th anniversary. I think it's done a good job. It could always have done more, but when you're setting up anything that's new, it takes a while to establish yourself, and particularly when you're setting up some sort of authority, because you have to go through various bureaucratic hurdles. You've got to, create various reports, papers, plans that you've got to produce. So it now has a local plan for planning. It's also got a management plan in terms of how it wants to see, areas across the South Downs evolve and develop. And that's developed with partners within the landscape. It's not something it dictates to people. But I think, at times, people have frustrations as well. Could it have done more? But I think it's always difficult in those early years. Now it's established, I think now is the time that it really needs to show what it's made of, if you like. The next 10 years, I think, are an ideal opportunity to actually do some quite radical things.
Yeah.
Some of that links into what you've just talked about in terms of chalk grassland, for example. Climate change is going to be a big issue that's not going to go away. So it's what, you know, some of those things are, what does that mean for the South Downs landscape? How can we look after chalk grassland? Ancient chalk grassland is like our tropical rainforest. It might not seem like it because it's so small and
flat.
But
there's a lot of biodiversity. Tell us about chalk grassland.
Well, it's got 40 species. You know, the really rich stuff's got 40 species per square metre.
So butterflies.
And that supports a whole range of insect life, such as butterflies, etc., and the sort of iridescent Adonis blue, if you like. And you know that chalk hills don't exist many places in the world. There's some in France, some in New Zealand, and a few other places, but very, very few areas, you know, generally internationally, and chalk grassland even less. So actually, what we have is not just special for us; it's special internationally. And now we have less than 4% of the South Downs is covered by ancient chalk grassland. This really springy turf that, you know, the Victorians used to revel on, because it's, you know, it's like walking on rubber, if you like, in terms of the bounce that you've got and the richness of the grass.
How much?
I don't know the coverage it was before, but what we've got, it was far more extensive because it was created in a sense by the sheep and corn economy of having all the sheep roaming across the South Downs, and certainly on the eastern part of the Downs, the vast majority would have been this ancient chalk grassland. Now a lot of that has been lost because it's been ploughed up or it's left to scrub over, for example. So sort of tackling that is important, and actually the key thing that the National Park Authority is trying to reconnect the patches that they've got to create, you know, corridors and bigger areas where species can move around, so that, you know, with climate change coming, different temperatures, etc., different rainfall, the species can move and adapt and exist elsewhere without going extinct. And then also looking at what else do we need to do with the South Downs? What can we do with the South Downs to actually help with climate change? And some of that could be looking about making sure there's no runoff, flooding, you know, with the extra torrential rain that we're going to get in the winters, as we've been seeing this autumn and this winter. How can we try and make sure that we don't get flash floods coming off down off the hills and flooding the homes? What do we need to do on the South Downs to prevent that? What do we need to do in terms of sort of trapping in carbon, you know, into the landscape, so that we're locking it in so that it's not causing the problem in terms of climate change? So I think there's some real opportunities there. And then you've got the sort of the human issues, which are housing, transport, you know, the perennial ones that never go away. How, you know, what can the National Park Authority do for them?
Just before we finish up, do you think there will be greater calls to build on the South Downs? Because Brighton's obviously surrounded by the South Downs and the sea. So there is going to be a call on councils to build on South Downs, which I guess is quite difficult. I mean, if they did want to build an area, how does that happen? Do you see that happening?
I expect there always will be calls, because people don't always understand the planning process. They don't always understand what's in the national park and where it is. And also, I think, because we have quite an intensive agricultural landscape, don't necessarily appreciate it and have the access to it that, you know, we feel, you know, people should have. And I think when that happens, people will appreciate the landscape even more than they do already, and that's pretty high. But in terms of housing being built on the South Downs, yes, there will be calls. Yes, it may or may not be successful in the future. I don't think any time in the near future it will happen, but longer term, we can't dictate what's going to happen in the far future.
So just before we finish up, then, what are the Friends of the Earth? How do they look after the South Downs? How do they work with the countryside authority that looks after the South Downs?
Well, we engage with the South Downs National Park Authority through a network of organisations called the South Downs Network, and that came out of organisations that were all involved with the campaign for the national park.
Yeah.
And equally, we work at a local level within, say, Brighton and Hove, and we've been working very strongly over the issues with the Hollingbury and Waterhall golf courses, for example. And also looking at what Brighton can do with its whole estate. You know, 12,000 acres of downland, which actually stretch beyond the boundaries of Brighton and Hove, provides a real opportunity for opening up the downland for wildlife and for people, and doing a lot of good. We're not achieving it yet, but we think there's real potential there, so we are pressing the council to take better action on that.
Yeah, and with climate change, obviously, that's going to drastically affect. How do you see climate change? What's the greatest threat to the South Downs from climate change? And I guess the biodiversity would be the number one issue, or is there?
It depends how bad it gets, to be honest. I think there are different threats in different places. So I've already mentioned the issue of flooding around the urban fringes, but in threats to the South Downs themselves, higher rainfall and higher sea levels, which we're getting, are going to mean that the chalk cliffs erode much faster, which also means that they'll become more unstable. So walking near the top of them is going to be more problematic, potentially more risky.
Yeah.
Longer term, if sea level rises, if we don't contain climate change and sea level rises become quite dramatic, then I would expect then to see development happening on the South Downs, because we will lose a lot of places like Shoreham and parts of Hove will go underwater.
Yeah.
And people will have to move to higher ground. But I mean, that's all starting to begin to sort of...
Sounds like a movie. Yeah.
Well, I'm sure there is a movie there, yeah. I'm sure there has been one. Yeah. But you know, that's some way off in the future. Yeah. And we have opportunity to actually, you know, stall that and stop that happening, but only if we start taking action now and taking serious action very, very quickly.
Yeah, and I'm sure we're going to be talking about that on latest TV news a lot in a couple of weeks and months. Sure. Thanks, Chris, for coming in today. Cheers. Thanks.
Thank you.